Castles can be found all over Japan. With their elegant towers surrounded by massive stone walls, they have an architectural beauty that is unique. Originally erected in key locations to defend the surrounding areas, over the centuries many castles became centers for growing urban populations. Today they are tourist destinations attracting crowds of visitors. The primary function of these castles was as military fortresses. The layout of Himeji Castle, which is now a World Heritage Site, includes numerous features designed to repel attackers trying to reach the central tower. Castles were also symbols of authority. During the civil wars of the 16th century, warlords such as Oda Nobunaga and Tokugawa Ieyasu displayed their dominance by erecting magnificent castles. In recent years, modern-day craftsmen have been working on restoration programs to recreate the gorgeous decorations that once adorned these palaces. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we explore the history of these castles and discover the power and beauty of their magnificent architecture.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Today I'm in the city of Odawara, which is about 80 kilometers southwest of Tokyo. I'm standing in the entrance of Odawara Castle, and behind me, this gate here, is a reconstruction of the original one. This one was built in 1997. In front of the gate, there's a moat and a stone wall, the archetypal image of a Japanese castle. The focal point of any castle in Japan is the central tower, or donjon. And in the case of Odawara Castle, the donjon is up there behind those trees. We'll take a closer look at it later in the program. Standing right under the gate here, you feel the sheer scale of the thing. It's quite magnificent. And we haven't even entered the building yet. The two main features of every Japanese castle are the donjon and the surrounding stone fortifications. And in that sense, all Japanese castles are at least superficially quite similar. And in fact, they were all built during a very short period of time, about 50 years, basically the second half of the 16th century. This was the culmination of a long period of civil war, which started around the middle of the 15th century, and finished around the beginning of the 17th, when the country was finally unified. On today's show, we'll be seeing how and why all of these castles were built within that short period of time. But first of all, we'll take a look at the role they played in ancient Japan. Certainly, they're all architectural masterpieces, but they're much more than that. They were also built with many hidden features, which made them powerful military fortresses.
Castles are found in all parts of Japan. Many cities around the country have developed from the towns that sprang up around these medieval military bases. Of Japan's 47 prefectures, 36 of the capital cities were originally castle towns. Boasting massive stone walls and beautiful donjon towers, these castles are now popular sightseeing attractions, drawing numerous visitors. Almost all of those castles were built during a time span of only about 50 years, from the second half of the 16th century, towards the end of the Warring States period. The central donjons were the final line of defense. But besides their function as fortresses, they were also a way for warlords to demonstrate their power by making them look as impressive as possible. Himeji Castle is considered the ultimate in Japanese castle architecture. It is a national treasure, and in 1993 it was also designated a UNESCO World Cultural Heritage Site. Because of the elegance of its tall, white central donjon, it is known as the White Egret Castle. But it was also designed to be impregnable against attack. Himeji Castle features many of the hidden defenses that made these castles such formidable military fortresses. The compound surrounding the castle is divided into a complex arrangement of stone walls and moats. This layout was developed to make it as difficult as possible for attackers to reach the buildings at the centre. The entire castle is protected by massive walls of stone. The individual stones, some large, some small, are fitted together with superb skill. The height and angles of the individual stones were carefully worked out to repel attacking forces and to make it as hard as possible for them to scale the walls. Any attackers that did manage to get inside the castle would have to make various detours before they could finally reach the main gate, the Hishinomon. Having broken through that gate, they would then be faced with a second gate, known as the Inomon. Although it seems very close, this is actually a trap. The attackers would naturally try to rush straight at the next gate. But there are hidden areas where the defending warriors would be hidden, so they could attack the enemy warriors from behind and stop them from breaking through further. Defending troops would also be stationed at slit-like gaps in the walls. The soldiers posted at these openings could aim at the enemy with their bows and arrows or firearms. At one time, Himeji Castle had more than 3,000 of these defensive slits, of which 997 still exist today. The path leading to the base of the tower is narrow and winding and also runs uphill. As the crow flies, the distance from the first gate to the Donjon Tower is just 130 meters. However, attackers trying to reach it would have to climb a route at least three times longer. The path veers sharply to the left, making the donjon seem a long way behind instead of being in front. This would confuse the attackers, leaving them exhausted and demoralized, trapped in a maze in which they felt they weren't getting any closer. Once they reached the donjon, they would find further defenses. The tower itself rises from on top of a 15-meter high base, with sheer walls of solid stone that would be very hard to scale. If the attackers tried to climb those walls, the defenders would be ready to drop stones or scalding water on them through apertures overhead. The main donjon is equipped with an underground storehouse. This would have been stocked with enough food and fuel to withstand a lengthy siege. Running up the core of the massive donjon tower are two central pillars, each 25 meters high and 95 centimeters thick. These pillars give the tower its structural strength. This construction method had a long history of use in erecting the tall pagodas at Buddhist temples. It's a very strong design, which gives the building great resilience against earthquakes. The most obvious features of Japanese castles are their massive stone walls and soaring donjon towers. But behind their elegant facades, they were also highly effective military fortresses, built with numerous elements that made them ready for battle.
And here we have the second main gate to the castle. This one's another reconstruction done in 1971. This is the largest and the most robust of the gates into the castle. And beyond this, you have the inner compound known as the Honmaru, which has the donjon at its center. You see it up close, this is massive, it's really imposing, and it's certainly wouldn't have been easy to get into the castle beyond here. Again, then, you have these walls which constructed with remarkable skill and using these enormous stones. Look at the size of this. Odawara Castle's development as a military stronghold reached its peak in the 16th century under the Hojo clan, who ruled this whole part of eastern Japan with Odawara as their power base. In those days, towns were built with strategic defense systems using moats, earthworks, and walls all built around them. In the case of Odawara, those defenses covered an area with a circumference of about 9 kilometers. In fact, Odawara was the largest medieval fortress in Japan. There are specific historical reasons why castles were built so powerfully to withstand attack, as we're going to see on our next video.
The age of the samurai warriors in Japan dawned at the end of the 12th century with the start of the Kamakura Shogunate. This brought to an end a long period of peace and led to centuries of military maneuvering and warfare. In medieval Japan, many fortresses were built on top of hills or mountains. In the 14th century, Chihaya Castle was built by a leading military commander, Kusunoki Masashige. He used the whole of a steep mountain as his fortress, defending himself from potential attackers by constructing an elaborate system of defenses, including earthworks and moats. Launching attacks from on high was a powerful battle strategy. Because Japan has so many hills and mountains, many such fortresses were built in these strategic locations. During the 16th century, there was a major change in the methods used for fighting in Japan. After the introduction of firearms in 1543, rifles and cannons soon replaced bows and arrows in warfare. As a result, the way castles were built also underwent a radical change, to defend against attacks using firearms. Osaka Castle was built by Toyotomi Hideyoshi, the warlord who unified Japan. Its compound covered a huge area to ensure that cannon fire could not reach the donjon at the center. Modern-day Osaka Castle, with its surrounding park, covers an area of about 1 million square meters. But when it was first built, the castle compound was 4 or 5 times bigger. The area covered by the elegant Himeji Castle originally covered a much wider area than it does today. The land around the tower was divided by an inner moat, a middle moat, and an outer moat. From the edge of the outer moat, it would have been very hard to hit the central donjon using the kind of cannons available at that time. From the 16th century, solid stone walls were built around many castles. Kumamoto Castle was considered totally impregnable. Its massive stone walls could keep out any attacks with guns or cannons. The castle compound itself was split up with numerous walls of stone, covering a total area of 70,000 square meters. In all, an estimated 280,000 stones were used to build these walls. Castles were also symbols of power and prestige. Oda Nobunaga, the warlord who seized control of virtually all Japan, wielded huge power. In 1576, he started work on a castle on top of a small hill overlooking Lake Biwa. Named Azuchi Castle, it was the first in Japan to be built with a fully developed tower. It was from his base here that Nobunaga began his campaign to unify the country. The tower was an architectural masterpiece. It's believed to have been decorated with paintings depicting ancient Chinese legends. It took over 3 years to construct, with more than 3,000 people at work on it every day. Erecting this magnificent castle helped to increase Nobunaga's influence throughout the country. Tokugawa Ieyasu, the first Edo shogun, also displayed his power by building castles. One of the most famous in all the country was constructed in Nagoya. Ieyasu ordered the daimyo, the rulers of the feudal provinces, to build a castle for his son. Altogether, more than 5 million people are said to have worked on it. The lords vied with each other to show their loyalty to the new shogun by providing workers and by transporting the timbers and massive stones to the site. Drawing such a large number of workers was also a way for Ieyasu to demonstrate his power. The Tokugawa shogunate from the start of the 17th century established a long period of peace in Japan. Nijo Castle, the shogun's residence in Kyoto, was originally built with a donjon at the center. But after it was destroyed by fire, the tower was never rebuilt. Because castle donjons were symbols of war, the shogunate banned their construction and limited the number of castles to one per province. No longer used as military fortresses, the function of castles changed, becoming the seats of regional power. The Nidomaru Palace at the heart of Nijo Castle was an important location where the shoguns received envoys from the imperial court. Accordingly, the palace was adorned with lavish decorations. Reflecting the change in the function of castles in Japan, the Nidomaru Palace has survived as an example of the art and architecture of that period.
It's been a fairly long walk from the outer gate, but finally, here we are. This is the donjon of Odawara Castle. This is, again, a reconstruction. This was built in 1960, modeled on illustrations going back as far as 1706 to give an idea of what it would have looked like in the Edo period. From the base of the wall here up to those ornaments right at the top, it's almost 40 meters high. Really is a massive structure. Over the last several decades, many castles around Japan have been rebuilt in this way as symbols of their cities. One of the most famous is Kumamoto Castle in Kyushu, down in the west of Japan. That one was almost entirely burned down in the 19th century and was finally reconstructed after the Second World War.
Kumamoto Castle is one of the most renowned in Japan. Its donjon, rebuilt in 1960, is 37 meters high. It was constructed in 1607 by Kato Kiyomasa, a regional lord who built several other important castles. The Honmaru Palace at the center of the castle, which burned down 130 years ago, was recently rebuilt. In 1999, before the rebuilding program started, a thorough archaeological excavation was conducted at the site of the Honmaru Palace. Many important artifacts were unearthed in the place where Kiyomasa conducted his administrative affairs, including roof tiles, swords, and metal fixtures. This metal fixture is 10 centimeters across. It's decorated on the front with the design of paulownia, chrysanthemums and Chinese bellflowers, against a surface etched with indentations just 1 millimeter deep. This artifact illustrates the intricate craftsmanship and skill of the artisans 400 years ago. Finds like this are evidence of how much effort went into the construction of the Honmaru Palace. This floor plan, dating back to the Edo period, that was kept inside Kumamoto Castle, shows the original layout of the Honmaru Palace. It was used as reference for the reconstruction work. At the center of the palace was a chamber called the Shokun no Ma. Many artifacts were unearthed from this area, and recreating this room became the focus of the reconstruction program. The work of rebuilding the Honmaru Palace began in September 2003. When the Donjon Tower was rebuilt, it was made with ferro-concrete. But for reconstructing the Honmaru Palace, only wood was used, both for the framework and the interior fittings. Around 40,000 logs were needed for the project, which were mainly gathered from inside Kumamoto Prefecture. No nails were used for the joints. The timbers were put together in the traditional way, cutting and joining them with the utmost precision. The job of recreating the decorative metal fixtures that were unearthed during the archaeological survey was entrusted to a workshop in Kyoto that has restored other national treasures. The technical skills for producing these fixtures reached their peak during the 16th century, the period when castle building was at its height. Using similar techniques, the modern-day craftsmen etched the flower patterns into the surface of the fixtures. By 2005, 2 years after the reconstruction project began, the Honmaru Palace at the heart of Kumamoto Castle was ready to be roofed. The tiles for the roof were formed one by one, using molds taken from old tiles unearthed at the site. A total of 140,000 had to be produced. Recreating the walls was a complex process. First, an underlying structure was formed using a grid of bamboo. Then, coarse rope was attached to the bamboo struts. An inner layer of mud was first applied, leaving the ends of the ropes exposed. Then a second layer of mud was applied to cover the rope. This technique gives the walls greater strength. To render the exterior white walls, the craftsman with 50 years of experience was brought in to ensure they would be smooth as a mirror. He was also a member of the team that rebuilt the Donjon Tower. His great skill was called on to render the walls of the Honmaru Palace. Specialists were also brought in to create the murals inside the Shokun no Ma chamber at the heart of the palace. They were artists who had helped to restore screen paintings inside Kyoto's Nijo Castle. They pored over the designs, creating numerous alternatives before deciding on the final images. It took them more than 4 years to complete their work. Reconstruction of the Honmaru Palace in Kumamoto Castle was completed in December 2007. Built in the traditional Shoin-zukuri style, with interconnecting chambers, it required a total of 40,000 timbers. The original Shokun no Ma, which was only used by Lord Kiyomasa, was decorated with vibrant colors. The reconstruction is exquisitely detailed, bringing to life what it must have looked like when it was first built by Kiyomasa. Thanks to the work of these modern-day craftsmen, the vision of the ancient castle builders, and the sophisticated building skills dating back 400 years have been reborn.
Well, finally made it to the top. And it's a rather nice view out here. That's the Izu Peninsula over there with many, many beautiful hot springs. This donjon of Odawara Castle is the third incarnation. There are many castles which have been rebuilt once. This one's been rebuilt twice. The original one burnt down after an earthquake in the Edo period. It was then rebuilt, and then the Meiji government in the latter part of the 19th century ordered it destroyed. So, as I said a moment ago, this one was finally rebuilt in 1960. Other parts of Odawara Castle that had been burnt down have been gradually rebuilt over the years as part of an overall reconstruction project. As I mentioned earlier in the show, most of Japan's castles were built during a fairly short period of time towards the end of the 16th century, when Japan was still in the throes of ongoing civil strife. But with the beginning of the Edo period, at the start of the 17th century, Japan entered an era of peace, and there was no longer any demand for castles, especially for their military aspects. On our final video, we'll take a look at the more modern history of Japanese castles in the post-Edo era.
Because the donjon towers inside castles were originally built as military fortresses, there was no use for them during the long period of peace in the Edo period, and the shogunate imposed restrictions on repairing them without permission. Since the regional lords did not want to incur the displeasure of the shogun, in many castles the towers were abandoned and allowed to fall into ruin. However, after the Second World War, many cities began repairing or reconstructing their castles. To keep alive their history as castle towns, and also to create tourist attractions, there was a boom for rebuilding the old buildings. Using modern construction techniques, new life was breathed into these historic sites. Chambers inside the rebuilt castles are now often used as museums or observation areas, which are popular with visitors. These castles, which were originally built for war, have been given new roles befitting the present era of peace. Japan's castles were built at a time when the country was in a state of constant warfare. Now, four centuries later, these magnificent buildings are still loved and treasured.
Features of every Japanese castle are the donjon and the surrounding stone fortifications. And in that sense, all Japanese castles are at least superficially quite similar. In fact, they were all built during a very short period of time, about 50 years, basically the second half of the 16th century. This was the culmination of a long period of civil war, which started around the middle of the 15th century and finished around the beginning of the 17th, when the country was finally unified. On today's show, we'll be seeing how and why all of these castles were built within that short period of time. But first of all, we'll take a look at the role they played in ancient Japan. Certainly, they're all architectural masterpieces, but they're much more than that. They were also built with many hidden features, which made them powerful military fortresses.
Castles can be found all over Japan. With their elegant towers surrounded by massive stone walls, they have an architectural beauty that is unique. Originally erected in key locations to defend the surrounding areas, over the centuries many castles became centers for growing urban populations. Today they are tourist destinations attracting crowds of visitors. The primary function of these castles was as military fortresses. The layout of Himeji Castle, which is now a World Heritage Site, includes numerous features designed to repel attackers trying to reach the central tower. Castles were also symbols of authority. During the Civil War, castles are found in all parts of Japan. Many cities around the country have developed from the towns that sprang up around these medieval military bases. Of Japan's 47 prefectures, 36 of the capital cities were originally castle towns. Boasting massive stone walls and beautiful donjon towers, these castles are now popular sightseeing attractions, drawing numerous visitors. Almost all of those castles were built during a time span of only about 50 years, from the second half of the 16th century, towards the end of the Warring States period. The central wars of the 16th century, warlords such as Oda Nobunaga and Tokugawa Ieyasu displayed their dominance by erecting magnificent castles. In recent years, modern-day craftsmen have been working on restoration programs to recreate the gorgeous decorations that once adorned these palaces. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we explore the history of these castles and discover the power and beauty of their magnificent architecture.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Today I'm in the city of Odawara, which is about 80 kilometers southwest of Tokyo. I'm standing in the entrance of Odawara Castle, and behind me, this gate here, is a reconstruction of the original one. This one was built in 1997. In front of the gate, there's a moat and a stone wall, the archetypal image of a Japanese castle. The focal point of any castle in Japan is the central tower, or donjon. And in the case of Odawara Castle, the donjon is up there behind those trees. We'll take a closer look at it later in the program. Standing right under the gate here, you feel the sheer scale of the thing. It's quite magnificent. And we haven't even entered the building yet. The two main